Alright, looks like we're live. Hi, and welcome to Veiled Fury Entertainment. My name is Manuel, also known as ManuFS, and I will be your host and GM for tonight. This is a brand new channel where I will run pen and paper games for a live audience. The sessions will also be available in higher visual and a little bit audio quality on YouTube. I think tomorrow or the day after. Tomorrow. Right, tonight's game is going to be Savage Shadowrun Second Edition, my very own adaptation of Shadowrun 2 for the Savage Worlds rule system. And here with me are three lovely and great players. We'll begin with Matt Stark, who will play Twizzler, a Japanese decker. Say hello, Matt, and tell us something about your character.
Hi, I am playing Akita Yakamoto, aka Twizzler. He is a He is the son of a Yakuza member, a middle-class punk that's trying to make a name.
Awesome. Next we have Harrison Hunt as Bleak Tomorrow, a human sorcerer. Say hi, Harrison.
Hello, Harrison. I am playing Bleak Tomorrow. He is a human mage, and his real name is Jeffrey Woodbine. He comes from the ghetto, and he was inspired by comic books to become a superhero, although that didn't really work out, so he became a Shadowrunner instead. And that was the only way he found to beat folk up legally. Well, not quite legally, but nonetheless.
Ah, that's promising. All right, and last but certainly not least, we have Nick Lambley as Paint Station, a troll street samurai.
Hi, yeah, I'm playing Paint Station. Is a trial ex-wrestler, a semi-professional wrestler who had to quit that profession due to an incident in the ring when someone got killed and now just trying to make a living and forget about his past on the streets as a Shadowrunner.
Alright, very good. Then, as a short introduction... The year is 2054. A lot has happened in the meantime. Mainly that magic has returned to the world, and with the return of magic, it brought a lot of fantasy races back with it. Trolls, orcs, dwarves, elves, and some other races that are not, of which there are not that many around. The dragons have returned, and they are more devious and evil than ever. Mostly they run corporations or high-profile terrorist organizations nowadays. The internet has evolved into a global spanning life hallucination called the Matrix, which was invaded by a computer virus of never before seen lethality in the year 2029, and from that it spawned the current generation of the Matrix and the people who run the Matrix and try to get into other people's hideouts and secrets, where they actually literally put their brain on the line to get behind the defenses called ICE, which can and try to fry your brain if you are not very careful. Countries as they are still do exist but hold little power nowadays. Mostly power is concentrated in the hands of big corporations. There are 8 so-called mega corporations and a lot smaller, many smaller corporations. The mega corporations have extraterritoriality, meaning they, in the eyes of the law, they count as a separate country. They make their own laws, they have their own currency, and they are allowed to shoot you or do worse things to you if they catch you trying to break into their property and steal their secrets. In between the normal working populace and the corporations is the criminal underworld, and there lives the Shadowrunner, a lawless mercenary hiring his talents out to either corporations or countries or organized crime if they can pay for his services to render said services, whatever they may be. In the case of our illustrious group, Twizzler is a decker. He runs the Matrix and breaks into digital hideouts and fortresses and tries to gain valuable pay data. If you haven't noticed yet, my mother tongue is not English, so this is going to be a little bit holperig, as we say in German. I think you can guess what I mean. Bleak Tomorrow is a sorcerer. He has access to magic. He can cast spells. Pain Station is a street samurai. A street samurai is basically a modern warrior. They usually, but don't all of them, have an honor code by which they live by. They augment their body with implants to make them faster, tougher, and overall better than your average human. Well, as I said, the year is 2054, and we find ourselves in the beautiful city of Chicago. It is late 2054. It's winter, snow has fallen. In this, there's something wrong with this picture you are seeing. And that something wrong is in the middle right corner of the picture, namely the Sears Tower. The Sears Tower in 2054 doesn't exist anymore. Chicago had in 2029, if I'm not mistaken, happened something called the Night of Rage, when a lot of then racist groups. Racism has changed. It's now no longer the Japanese versus the Aryans and such stuff. It's basically it's humans versus orcs versus dwarves. That's the new racism. In 2029, the Night of Rage happened when a lot of organized racists went out on a organized hunt for metahumans, as they are called. The Night of Rage was a very dark and very bloody chapter. And 3 days afterwards, one of the ultra-racist groups called Alamos 20K blew up the Sears Tower and made it look like retaliation of certain metahuman groups for the Night of Rage. The tower collapsed, burying, I think, about 2 blocks worth of buildings under it, and the rubble itself caused tremendous loss of life. That area has never been rebuilt. It's been completely abandoned. It's called the Shatter Graves nowadays, and it's located in an area called the Noose. The Noose is a very, very low income, borderline war zone kind of area. It's pretty much a ghetto for all the people who really have nothing except what they can carry with them and defend with sharp sticks and knives, controlled by gangs and such. The Shatter Graves themselves are a different kind of terrain. They are populated by ghouls. Ghouls are, they exist again. Ghouls are awakened creatures. They feast on flesh. Usually dead, but if it's living and kicking and screaming, if it's easy to catch, they don't say no to that. It's also haunted by a lot of spirits of people who died in the crash of the Sears Tower. So people usually don't go near the Shatter Graves, and even the people who live in the Noose try to avoid it. It's really, really, a really, really dangerous, perhaps the most dangerous part of Chicago. Notes. I have notes. All right. So all of you guys have worked the odd jobs in the past, and for the past few weeks, it's been a bit of a dry spell. Luckily, you had some money put aside, so it hadn't hit you all that hard. But when people reached out to you and told you, "Hey, I probably have work for you," it's a little strange, but the guy throws around a lot of money, so... Watch your back, but hey, why don't you go check it out? And they send you an address and a time, and as it's so often done, a code word for the barkeeper to identify yourself.
And okay, so we're going to fight.
So the address.
We're going separate, correct?
The address itself is located in the north side of Chicago. The north side is rather low income. It's home to a lot of slaughterhouse industries, where Pain Station, for example, worked for a while in his life as a meat packer, or meat hacker in his case.
Of course.
Yeah. So it's an area where nobody really pays much attention if you run around even lightly armed. Probably not a bad idea to run around lightly armed, especially the nearer you get to the noose, because the gangs tend to try to make an easy pick every now and then. The bar itself, you have never heard of, and I'm pretty sure Twizzler is going to go look online for what's there to know about it, and it's really just a hole in the wall.
Okay, so were we all petitioned separately to go there, or were we recruited as like a team?
No, your respective fixer contact sent you a message with the before mentioned details. It's the job has a strange feeling to it, but the guy offers a lot of money and seems a little desperate. So go there, check it out, and if you think it's all right, should be easy money.
Well, that's what I'm going to do then.
Yeah.
Big Tomorrow fears no man, except he very much does, but outwardly he doesn't.
In Twizzler's case, it's a little bit different. The info you got comes through your father, and he doesn't tell you much more than the others, but he tells you, go there, take the job, and report anything to me. You get the feeling that's not really from his own initiative. That's something from higher up, from an Oyabun higher up that just got passed down, and you're the one who's gonna be on the front runner on this one.
Okay. Did he give me a name? Anything to research?
He doesn't have a name. He has the bar, and everything else should. So just go there, collect intel.
I'm pretty
much
in the dark.
Yeah, pretty much. You get the feeling that's all he knew too. He didn't know very much either, so he just got told, send somebody over there to check it out. So
I guess I'll head over to the bar.
The meeting is set for the following day, evening hours. It's really bloody cold. Fresh snow has fallen, which in this case means in the area of the north side that the snow is mostly darkish gray even while it's still falling, and it just goes downhill once it reaches the ground. Chicago is home to a lot of heavy steel industry, heavy steel manufacturing, and that sort of industry. So white snow is usually what the people in the high-end districts get, because they import it and shoot it up with snow cannons, so they have white snow.
Is there a bouncer or a security guard outside the bar when I get there?
Yep, there's an orc standing there. He's wearing a leather jacket with the color of the local gang.
Okay, when I get there, I'm wearing my full Shadowrun gear. I never leave the house without it. I know a lot of Shadowrunners try to look inconspicuous, but that is not Bleak Tomorrow's MO. I flip up the visor on my motorcycle helmet and I look at the orc and I go, "Excuse me, sir." I realize I forgot my voice mask and I go, "Excuse me, sir."
He looks at you rather bored, takes a drag from his cigarette. "Yeah, what you want?"
"How much to get in?"
"What?"
"I'm business here tonight."
"It's a bar, dumb fuck. You go in, you pay, you don't make trouble."
"I thought there might be an entrance fee. I'm extremely sorry to have wasted your time. I'm..."
He flicks the cigarette at your breast and says, "Piss off."
"I'm sorry." I walk in.
Yep, the bar itself is, it's really a very rundown bar. Has seen better days. It's
Are there any shady characters about?
You wouldn't per se say shady characters. It's mostly hardworking folk who just try to forget the hardships of the day over synthetic alcohol and maybe a card game or something.
In that case, I feel a sense of relief as I walk in, because Bleak Tomorrow thought that it was going to be a kind of very fighty, knifey type bar, and as a result, he feels relief.
No, not really. There's a larger than average percentage of trolls. And from what they're wearing, you can see they work in the slaughterhouse districts. But they all seem to just be here to just get some beers into them before they go home to their families.
My code word, that's for one of the bar workers, right?
Yeah, you're supposed to go to the bartender and ask him for Larry.
Let me handle this.
Okay, I guess Troll approaches me and says, "Let me handle this then." I put down my visor and go, turn my voice mask on and go,
"Who's asking? Who? What do you want to know, you fuck?"
"Be pain station."
"Listen, you don't approach the man who's wearing a cape and start talking to him. I'm the one who talks."
"You're in a troll bar. You're outnumbered."
"Listen, I got business in this place. Don't come up and start talking to me."
Oh, I didn't establish how I got my orders, Manuel. What was it again? Sorry.
Maybe
I'm just talking to a random guy now. I forgot.
He just came up to me and started talking to me.
Yeah.
Which is absolutely awesome. So everybody starts with a fixer connection for free. So you know somebody who just pushes jobs your way and is your provider for equipment and cyberware and implants and such things. And you got that job notice from him.
Sweet. Okay.
"I got my job from Fairly Johnson over at the comic store."
"I not know. You're funny. Pain station like you. I slap you on the shoulder."
"I'm not supposed to be funny. I'm supposed to be scary."
"I'm going to pull you in for a hug."
"No, get off me."
I'll start noogieing. Oh, no, you've got a helmet on, haven't you? So I can't. Yeah, I'm just going to give you a squeeze and go, "You're funny, little guy.
No,
PlayStation like.
No, I'm scary. I'm not."
Okay, I turn my voice mask off and flip my visor up and I go, "So you're here for some kind of job then, I guess."
"That's right. Me work money. PlayStation like drinking.
Look, I'm trying to sort of have like an air of mystery, okay? Can you just..." "It's just, look, you've ruined it already. Are you here for the same job? The Jeff thing? Was it Jeff?"
"Yes. Air in here bad. Yes, Jeff.
Supposed to go to the bar and talk to Jeff. Ugh. We're supposed to like not go around telling everyone what the job is."
I've got to put my arm around him and just drag him to the bar laughing.
Stop it! No!
Awesome. Twizzler, as you get there, you can... You have front row seats to a bar that's mostly fallen silent and watched what happened between the two bozos who stood two steps away from the entrance on the inside and just had the most screwed up argument.
What does the bartender look like?
So human, male, he's in his 50s, and he looks like he's done this forever.
So I'm going to walk past these two up to the bar, and I'm wearing my black leather jacket and a bright yellow backpack. And walk up to the bar, and I say, "Hey, you." I say, "Code word, you take me to boss."
It depends if you know the code word, friend.
I got this.
Code word.
Jeff.
Oh, you're those guys. Yeah, it's on the back. Room labeled private. Can't miss it.
I'm going to turn around to the Japanese guy that just came in and say, "You Jeffing it too, mate?"
Who are you?
We're both, and then I hush my voice down a little bit. We're both Shadowrunners too. I'm new. It's pretty cool, huh? I mean, no, I'm not new. I've been doing this years. I adjust my glasses. I'm a pretty cool, slick cat guy kind of type dude. Been doing this.
Why do you wear a cape?
Because it's cool, pretty rad. Makes me pretty cool. Good for sneaking about, beating up bad guys. Am I right? Yeah. Let's do the mission. I walk away towards the bar guy, and Bleak thinks he looks really cool. I make sure my cape swoops as I walk away, and I think in the back of my mind that Twizzler is really impressed by the way I just spoke.
I'm going to look at Twizzler and go, "He funny. Come we, Jeff, me shadow banner too."
Right, so you walk into the back of the bar, and that's basically the way to the toilets and one room labeled private.
Which one does he go into? The toilets or the private one?
No, the bartender just sent you on your way. He's not accompanying you. He's manning the bar.
Oh. Which one do I go into, sir? Which way is...
The private one. You know, the one that's not labeled bathrooms.
Okay, well, I would argue that both rooms are quite private. Okay, and then I understand his meaning, and I go into the private room.
I'm going to walk into the toilet.
No, you've misunderstood, troll face.
What?
He wants us to go into the private room.
Oh. I walk back.
I'm just going to look down at the ground and shake my head.
Listen, I'm sorry, man. He's not a cool, slick pair of dudes like we are. You know what I mean? And I put my arm around Twizzler. We get it, right?
You look kind of weird, but you're cool.
Thanks, man. Hey, you like manga? Sorry, that's racist. Anyway, let's go. And then I walk into the private room, once again thinking that I really played that social interaction pretty cool.
Great. So everybody gets the first Benny of the night.
Ooh!
For
yay!
Some awesome character introductions and role playing. The room is pretty bare. It has a table with some rather uncomfortable looking chairs around it. And on the table is a metrics terminal, which looks pretty much like one of those old Macs. You know, the one that looked like a goldfish glass thing.
Mm. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, so that's pretty much what a metrics terminal looks like.
Okay.
So can I jack into the terminal?
You could, yeah. There's an access jack present for that. But as soon as you walk in and close the door, the terminal springs to life. The screen flickers for a moment with static, and then shows the face of a. It shows a generic computer-generated face. It's not. It doesn't even have texture on it. It's just a wire mesh image of a face. And the speakers crackle and spring to life. And the voice you are hearing is obviously is either. Run through some kind of voice distortion software, kind of like the voice mask uses, which Bleak Tomorrow has, or it's just plain computer generated. And yep, the voice says, "Welcome, gentlemen. Please sit down."
I go "Ooh!" and clap my hands like I've never seen anything like that before.
In fact, I'm pretty impressed by it too. I may be a nerd, but I'm pretty illiterate with computers. I'm more of a comic book kind of guy, so I sit down, but I do it like this. I sort of grab my cape like this, and I sit down slowly. And I say, "Okay, Tin Man."
I'm going to take a chair and put it behind the terminal so that they can't see me.
Yep. Yep, the terminal has a small camera built in the front. So whoever is watching obviously was able to see you come and enter the room and knew when the door would be closed.
Speak, Jeff.
"You come all highly recommended. I'm offering you a job to find a certain person. There is a limited time frame involved. The pay will be 50,000 Nuyen on completion, with an additional 5,000 Nuyen for each of you up front."
Cool, you got more money than sense, mate. I mean, yes. I will accept the fee. No, it depends on what the job is. Sorry, I'm new to this. I mean, I'm not new. I've been doing this years. Carry on, Jeff.
That 50,000 each?
No, 50,000 as a group completion goal bonus, but 5,000 each as an initial payment.
We're going to have to barter a little bit here, Twizzler. Make it 50,002.
"Your terms are acceptable. Does this mean you accept the job as a group?"
I am... nudge Twizzler as if I've done a well good job. Do we accept?
I'm just gonna look. I'm gonna look at you, and I'm gonna kind of like roll my eyes, and then look back at the terminal and say, "Yeah, that's fine."
Woo! We accept.
New job. Yes.
Hurrah!
"Very well. Please insert chip into chip reader of terminal. It will hold dossier on person you have to find. Find person as soon as possible."
Well, I already ate my lunch earlier. I don't have any potato chips.
I'm pretty sure.
Can I just put it in my chip jack?
Yeah, I'm pretty sure you Twizzler is carrying around a spare empty chip for whenever the reason needs one, the occasion needs one. So you can just slot that one into the terminal, and the light besides the chip reader flickers a bit for until the copy process is complete.
I have the computer illiterate hindrance. That's why I said.
Oh dear.
Okay, then I'll once the download's complete, I'll remove the chip and then put it chip jack.
"You will find access code for an account with 15,000 Nuyen on the chip. Good luck, gentlemen." And the screen goes dead.
Wait. Oh, blugger. Hey.
Well, who the Drek are we supposed to find?
On the chip is a... It's basically a text file with some images in it. On a person, you take a look at the picture, and he looks like an everyday average guy, somebody you would meet on the street and forget a nanosecond later. He's a guy about, which you would say he's in his late 40s, early 50s, is wearing a gray suit, obviously a very, very cheap one. And it looks like a picture taken from an employment file. There's a name to the picture. His name is James Vanderberg. There's an address to go with the name and the picture, a place of employment, and an additional file that is a detailed copy of his bank records over the past 8 weeks.
Okay.
And also there are access codes for a bank account with a bank based located in the Caribbean League with 15,000 million on it.
Okay, so we can...
Did you say there's a dossier on?
So a dossier in his name, the picture, and yeah, pretty much what I said. So it doesn't look like an official dossier, more like somebody cobbled together information for this guy in a hurry.
Okay, I'm gonna search the matrix for James Vanderbilt, see what I can find.
All right, make an investigation check, please. What?
Three.
Three.
I will spend a penny to re-roll up.
All right.
And a seven.
All right, that's better. Hold on a second. Just check something. Yeah. All right. The Matrix knows literally nothing about this guy. From a not very in-depth search, he has, of course, the equivalent to a kind of Facebook page, but that one doesn't really tell you anything besides his name and that he lives in Chicago, and that he at the moment works for a company named Flex Services.
Which, can we get an address to that company?
Yeah, you got his home address is in the dossier.
Okay.
So since I can't find anything, I'm assuming that either a fake name or he's trying very hard to remain hidden. Is there anything on the company that he works for?
It could be that he's just really, really unimportant. That's also a possibility. From the way he looks, it's either a very good fake ID or he is just so low on the corporate ladder that nobody gives a shit about him. Flex Services is easy to find. That's a company providing general administration services. So if somebody wants to outsource their bookkeeping, their human resources, facility management, and stuff, they handle that kind of shit.
Well, obviously, he's not a nobody because someone's paying 50,000.
Yeah. So we have to kill him, right?
Nope, you have to find him.
No, we're trying to find him.
Find him. Okay, I think I might know where he is. I've got a contact. Yeah? Yeah. Yeah, I'm part of the underworld too. Okay? I'm going to call up my contact. We're going to go and see my contact, all right? Oh, yeah, I don't have a phone.
Are you trying to persuade us?
Yeah. Can I borrow a phone?
Pain station have phone. I'll put my ear near his head.
Okay, just call up
I'm not going to use that. Just call up my buddy. Tell me you were looking for somebody. He always knows where to find people. I'm going to give him the number for my friend Fatty Johnson.
Yep.
Just tell him that I'm looking for somebody and I need to speak to him.
Okay. I'm going to just like punch the side of my head, put the number in. And then, cool.
Just say that that Bleak Tomorrow says hello and that I'm looking for somebody and that we're going to come and see him.
Oh, does it ring?
Yeah, it rings a few times and then a tired voice answers. Francis Johnson's Anime, Manga and Book Club, how can I help you?
Hello, is this Fatty Johnson?
Yes, this is Francis Johnson.
Little man says hi.
No, my name's... Say Bleak Tomorrow.
Bleak Morrow.
Yeah, Bleak... Okay, that's fine. Just say Jeffrey. Just say Jeff.
Oh, the Bleak Moron. Oh, right. Yeah, I know him. What's you want?
Just say that I'm going to be there in 5 minutes and I'm looking for somebody.
5 minutes looking for person. You help Bleak Man Small.
Sure.
Okay. Hang sure. up. Bye. Call him anchor, then hang up.
Love you. Bye.
That was absolutely rubbish.
He said, okay. Let's go. Pain station. Take you.
Anyway, I don't know why I'm still whispering, but this guy, he knows where to find people, okay? This is going to be amazing. You guys want to head over to my mate's shop?
Yes. Food?
Yeah, he'll have food.
Station hungry.
Okay, Station. We'll get you some food. Twizzler?
Yes. Twizzle, you like come.
Do you eat food in Mongolia?
Mongolia? I'm from Japan.
Yeah. But
Mongolia, Chinese. You know tell the difference from Chinese?
I know, but you know. Anyway, let's go. I'll give him a pat on the back.
I've already walked off.
All right.
You stop touching.
Where we're going. would you mind if we go to my contact's shop then?
Fine, we go.
Yeah, if you say you go, then you go.
Yeah, because I think... how long does it take us to get there?
More than 5 minutes.
Yeah, more than 5 minutes. Not so much because of the distance, but mostly because of the weather.
Okay. Oh, yeah, because it is snow.
Yeah, it's constantly snowing. It's freezing cold, so it's rather slippery at times. Takes a while to get somewhere.
While we're walking, I'm just going to tell these guys, don't worry. This guy's got all sorts of contacts. I'm going to sort this out. So when we get in there, you guys just hang by the entrance. So I'm going to speak to him. I'm going to get the info. Don't worry.
Okay.
Yeah, okay. I stay by the door.
I follow little man, though. He might get hurt.
No, I won't get hurt. You just hang by the door, because this is some big boy shit, all right?
Funny. I walk over and stand near Twizzler. Twizzle.
Twizzle. All right, when we go into the comic book shop, then I want to approach the counter and speak to Francis.
Yeah, the shop is... at this hour, it's the usual early night otaku crew.
Of course.
Hanging out, so a lot, basically a lot of people like Bleak Tomorrow.
Do I see anybody reading anything like Sailor Moon?
Sure.
As I go past these people, I slap the comics out of their hand and I say, read something less gay!
I'm so glad I labeled this channel for mature audiences.
Sorry. Anyway.
I would like to add that all the bad jokes and dark humor our characters make and my NPCs make do not reflect our actual views of the world. Thank you. So,
absolutely. All right.
That's Bleak Tomorrow's view. It's not mine. But yeah, he's just slapping books out of people's hands. And then he gets to the counter and he's like, you need to get better customers, Francis. This is ridiculous. People are reading Sailor Moon in here. Do you hear me? Sailor Moon!
Yeah, they pay good money for it. So what's up?
It's ridiculous. I hate it. Anyway, I'll take a few Spider-Mans, a couple of Batmans. I see you've got a Spider-Man pen down there. I'll take one of those.
Sure, one free for every purchase of 150 New Yen and above. So what do you want to talk to me about?
Nothing really. Have you got Dark Knight Returns? My one's a bit worn out. I'll take a couple of those too. Always need a couple of spares. Another thing is, I'm looking for a guy called James Vanders... What's his name? Vanderbeer. What's his name, Manuel?
I think it's rather in character for Bleak to just have forgotten the name.
Yeah. Okay, can I roll smarts a bit if you can remember it?
You can roll smarts to remember it, yeah.
Okay, I've got D10, thankfully.
He's quite smart, then.
Oh, I got a 4.
Yeah, all right. His name's James Vanderberg.
Okay, I'm looking for a guy called James Vanderberg. I actually was sort of trying to not really do any work and was just coming here to buy comic books, but while I'm here... do you know anything about a guy called James Vanderberg?
Not off the top of my head. He just goes over to his old beaten-up terminal, types in something. Nope.
Uh-oh.
Never shopped here.
Okay, I'm going to be in real trouble with these guys over here, so you've got to give me something, man.
Is this about the job I shoved your way?
Yeah, it is.
Holy shit, there was an actual job!
It was real, yeah.
Thoughts of yeah, okay. No,
what
sure.
Was that?
Yep, all good.
No.
Tell you what.
You started saying something.
Yes, I started to say I'm totally going to call some people, ask around. How's that?
Okay, look, you started to say something there, and if you don't tell me, I'm going to turn around and I'm going to say a bunch of racist stuff and say that I work here and all these people are never going to come back. So, you better tell me what you were going to say.
That's what you do on any given day you're here, and most of those guys are regulars who know you.
Oh, for goodness sake. You just can't win with you, can you? Okay, look, here's 1,000 New Yen.
Yeah, he goes like, okay. Yeah,
You know something you're not telling me.
No, I really don't know anything about that guy, but for 1,000, I will know something about that guy.
Okay. I give him 1,000 New Yen.
I'll send you a message when I find something.
Thanks, man. Much appreciated.
Yeah, sure. No problem.
I'm going to walk out, and as I pass people, what comics do I notice people are reading?
Most have picked up the Sailor Moon comics you smacked out of their hands and just continued reading, and were always watching out for what you were doing. So when you approach them, they just close the comic and hold it very close to them so you can't reach it, and wait until you pass them. There's some guys reading Yu-Gi-Oh, some guys reading Crying Freeman.
Okay, I pull the Yu-Gi-Oh comic out of the guy's hand and then throw it across the room. Idiot!
I was reading that!
Yeah, well, read this! I give him the middle finger.
How you do?
Okay, guys, it's done. Right, my guy's going to get some info. He's going to call us back soon.
What do you mean?
He's a number one scout. He's a cool guy. He's going to get some info. He's going to give us a call back soon. Don't worry about it. It's all good. I had to slap a few comics out of a few hands, but, you know, shit had to get real for a minute there. But let's go.
gonna shake my
head. You waste my time. We could be doing real work.
This is real work.
You did not. Where's the food, huh? Oh, you promised PlayStation food.
PlayStation hungry.
I'll get some. Okay, wait a minute. I run back up to the counter. Yo, Francis, you got any food?
What?
Just give me like a sandwich or something.
You know what? For a grand, sure. Here, have my dinner. And he just hands over McHugh's bag with a burger and probably what you think is a milkshake and some long cold fries in it.
Okay, I snatch it out of his hand and just run away. Okay, I'm going to give it to you guys. I'm like, here you go.
I don't like meat.
You don't like meat?
Oh.
Okay, you have the fries and the milkshake. The
station allergic to meat.
Okay, there's no meat in this. I give him the burger.
Make me sneeze.
There's no meat in this burger.
Oh.
It's meatless.
No. I smell it and go, no.
Yeah, you smell it and your nostrils just flare up with a prickling sensation. And it's not as bad as if you'd had ingested it, but it's like you just, I know this trick. And
I'm gonna grab Bleak tomorrow by the scruff of his shirt and lift him up and go, what me say?
Sorry. Eat the fries, have the milkshake, and Twizzler, here's the burger. Is that okay?
I'm gonna stick a couple Twizzlers in front of his face and say, here, you eat this.
Okay, thank you. That's really kind. Thank you.
I'm gonna hand Twizzler some of the fries and go, we share. And I'm gonna give him a squeeze his shoulder.
Can you put me down now, please?
Oh, yes. I'm going to put him down with my other hand. And then start eating my chips with a smile on my face.
Yeah. Yeah.
A lovely moment.
Yeah, as you view just drifts for a moment back to the inside of the shop, you can see the guy you knocked the Yu-Gi-Oh! Comic out of his hands, and he's just standing there and laughing. Like, he's usually very pale, but at the moment he's bright red, he's laughing so hard.
I look embarrassed. I put the visor down on my helmet.
Let's get out of here, guys.
Yeah, let's go to James Vanderberg's apartment.
Yeah. I'm just going to walk along eating fries. Giggling.
Yep. If you want to get to his apartment, you'd probably want to take a cab because that's it's called the North, and not the North Side, the West Side District. That's a pretty okay district, depending on where you go. It has some rather upscale areas, and it's mostly blue and white collar workers who live there and just commute to other areas. And if you could potentially walk, but you probably want to take either a bus or the monorail, or just hail a cab, unless somebody of you bought a car.
Whoops.
I don't think Station can drive.
I don't think he should drive. More.
Oh, no, actually. Oh, no, he can drive. He's got driving. Yeah, no, he can. Not very well, though, about.
Big metal box. Sorry about that. My cat wanted to get out. Does any of us have a car, though?
I don't
think so. Anyone have wheels? It.
Yeah, I don't think any one of you bought a car, so yeah, it's...
We get a taxoid.
Yeah.
Should we hail a taxoid?
Yeah.
Do you want to call them? I think that would be best.
What? On my head?
Call them on your head. Punch the number into the side of your head, mate.
Okay, I'm like, station, not no number.
I have a wrist phone also.
Yeah, okay. Hailing a cab is not a problem.
Okay. I just put my big arm out.
That should be easier with your big fat arms.
Yeah.
Right, so you hail a cab and you get asked when you hail for a cab, you get asked for a normal or an oversized one, and then you remember, oh yeah, right, we have a troll in the team. So you ask for an oversized cab, and that's basically, they send a minivan where one of the benches in the back is form-seated with an oversized seat, so a troll can comfortably sit down. So you head over to his apartment. It's an apartment in a... It's a block apartment. So, Big building with about 50 to 60 apartments in it. It's one of those... it's a little bit like those American motels where you have a stairway and the floors where you approach the individual rooms are on the outside of the building. You know what I mean?
Yeah, I know what you mean.
Yeah. So there's no security, yeah.
Nope. There's a keypad on the access gate to the stairwell though.
Okay. That's it, guys.
Well, I guess
we can't get past this.
Look at the. Do we have the code to get in? Was that in the dossier?
You look it over. Nope, the code wasn't in that.
Okay, I'll jack in with my CyberDuck. See if I can.
Yeah, it has a small.
I guess it'd be decrypt.
It has a small access port, and that's a straight decrypt role.
Now, do I get my wild die with the CyberDuck?
Yes, you get your wild die when you use utilities.
Sweet.
Okay, I got a 4.
Right, that's more than enough. It's an older model. It doesn't really put up much of a fight. And about half a second after you jack in, you have the ability to change the code to whatever you want.
So yeah, I'm going to change the access code to 2828 for everybody.
Cool.
Right, then you punch in 2828, bing, and it opens up.
That means nobody else has access.
That's amazing.
I like you guys.
I knew I hired you for a reason.
Friends.
No problem. I best Decker.
That's good. But you haven't seen my abilities. I can fly, you know.
I go, can you?
No.
I'll put you on my shoulders.
I bet PlayStation make you fly.
Okay, I get onto Pain Station's shoulders as we go up the stairs then, and I go, oh, put me down.
No. No,
it's demeaning. Stop it.
Do not have fun on Station's shoulder.
Look, it would be fun in a private setting, but now this is a mission.
It's like we said, Station wrestle.
No, stop it. I'm a paragon of justice, not a toy. No, stop it.
Station to top rope.
So, within the stairwell, that's all right, but once you get to the floor where the guy lives on, even Pain Station has to bow down a little bit to walk. It's obviously not a troll-sized building. So if he just conveniently forgets that Bleak Tomorrow is on his shoulders, that's going to be a very painful experience for Bleak Tomorrow.
Should I roll agility to sort of like get off of his shoulders then and dodge the
technically the top of the step? It's a grappling, so I think that's a contested strength roll if Pain Station really wants to hold on to you.
Well, it did seem like he was trying to hold on to me and I didn't want to, so
Pain Station wouldn't really think about that. He's just having a bit too much fun, so
I think we're gonna have to do it, man.
I think so too, mate. Okay.
Well, that is a big... A
contested strength or agility. Right. So you can roll agility if you like.
No, I'm going strength, mate. I got 9, mate. I exploded.
Nice.
I got a 2.
Wow.
I'm having too much fun. I'm not concentrating.
Okay. I'm going to activate my voice changer, and I'm going to have actual serious words with Pain Station. I go up to him and I go,
right, now you listen to me, you fuck. This is not a game. And what you need to do is stop treating it like it's not a game, because it's not a game. So you best learn the rules, because it's like football. Okay? It's not a game. And stop picking me up and shit, because it makes me look ridiculous. And I don't like it. It reminds me of school.
Okay, I just tap your helmet and go, Pet Station, sorry.
No, don't. See, it's shit like that, like patting me on the head.
I look at Twizzler and go, tell him to lighten up and start walking upstairs.
I don't feel like I got the point across.
You two start messing around. We go find this guy. Come.
I know, I'm trying to stop messing around. He was picking me. Okay, come on then.
So you walk up to the apartment door, and you can hear the sounds of people and families living here in the nearby apartments, but so far nobody has really taken notice of your arriving.
I draw my gun.
So you stand in front of a closed door.
Sounds dangerous, guys. I knock on the door.
No answer.
I'm going to try the handle.
Locked.
I'm going to kick the door.
Do you want to kick it in?
Yep.
All right, make an attack roll, a fighting. So rules-wise, the door has a parry of 2. So you're rolling mainly to see if you get a raise and do bonus damage.
I'm going to stand off to the side and put my hand inside my jacket like I'm going to reach for a gun.
I got a 7.
Okay, so you hit with a raise, so you roll your strength and an additional d6 for damage.
That's a 6, 7, 8. 7.
How much was that?
11.
Right, so you kick, you just... It's a light... it's not enough. You kick the door and it breaks off at the lock and swings inwards and bam, crack, bam, and it slams against the wall as you just kick it open.
I just shout, honey, I'm home. I'm walking. And I look at these two and go, come on, quick.
I run in, gun drawn.
Hands in the air!
The apartment.
Oh, by the way.
Yep. Yep.
I'm just going to stroll in behind him like I'm the boss or something.
Cool. I jump onto the bed.
Right. Yeah, what's that kind of party?
Like? Hold on a second. hold on a second. I am going to show you as soon as this bloody thing lets me. Right.
What are you going to show us, Manuel? It better not be your junk.
No, it's only 8:30. That's for after 10.
Okay.
Right, so that is the apartment you just entered. So if you... So Pain Station goes for... There's no light on. And there's barely any light coming in from the few windows there are. It looks like this one has a patio of some sort. That's another room. And the only windows this apartment has are besides the door and in the kitchen. It has a small window. There mm-hmm. are the shades are drawn close. So it's pretty okay, pretty dark. A paint station can see in the dark, no problem. He has infravision.
Yes.
It's been obviously there's nobody home at the moment, and you have an idea about what it looks like when people live in an area and have just left, because that leaves heat impressions and everything. This place is cold and dark.
What does it smell like?
Dust.
Okay, cool. I'll turn to the guys and I'm like, no one's been home for a long time. This room cold, like dead body, like meat. And then I shudder. Ugh.
Oh. Well, that's a bloody disappointment. Well.
I'm gonna go look in the refrigerator.
Yeah, should we have a route around?
There's some leftover dish, some dishes in the sink, which have only been slightly cleaned, and there at one point there was mold on it, but that even the mold has left for greener pastures at this point. In the fridge, you find a lot of. Basic soy food, so synthetic food stuff or artificially grown food stuff. Pretty much on the low scale, and it's a little hard.
So no energy drinks.
No energy drinks, and it's a little hard to say because that shit basically lasts forever. So if you buy something, it has a best before date 3 years in the future. So it's rather hard to say when it was bought. But
you can always tell a lot about a person by what they keep under their couch.
But what you notice is there's dust over everything. It's not a huge amount of dust, not like months and months and months worth of dust, but you'd say he hasn't probably been in his apartment for weeks. Not sure how many, but at least a few weeks since he's last been here.
Is there any signs of a struggle or anything like that, or is everything just left?
Everybody who wants to search the apartment for clues, give me a notice mm-hmm. roll, please.
I got an 8.
Nice.
5.
I got 9.
Sweet. So, overall, what I said, he hasn't obviously been here in quite some time. The there's no sign of a struggle of any kind. There's his clothing seems pretty much undisturbed. There's if you open up one of the drawers, there's clean underwear, clean socks, t-shirts, and the closet holds a few of his cheap suits, which pretty much all look like the one he is wearing in the picture of him you have. There's you find a few flyers laying around. Most of them are event flyers from a place called the Velvet Lady, and from the makeup of the flyers, it's probably a casino of some sorts, which offers additional services, mostly of the female variety, but. Probably of the male variety too.
Who found that, by the way?
This was the highest. You found that one, and there's also some flyers from a place called the Universal Brotherhood. You just have a glance. It's that one's actually a package full of flyers wrapped in plastic, like something you would hand out for somebody else to distribute. And it looks like a flyer for some kind of religious sect with unleash your inner strength, find salvation within yourself and with the help of others, and blah blah blah, all that nonsense.
As I find the prostitute one, you guys wouldn't have seen the flyer, obviously, but you can hear me just suddenly outburst, "Yes!"
What's matter?
Nothing.
Yeah.
I go, "No, what's matter?"
And walk over to him.
Just a second. Paint Station, while that's going on, Paint Station was attracted to a blinking light, which he finds to be his stationary home comm system and an answering machine.
Ooh, pretty.
Press the button, you idiot.
Okay, I'll push it with my big finger.
Oh, God. Does he mash the delete button by accident?
My big trolley finger, yeah.
You don't have the technical hindrance, right?
I have.
No, you're good. So, you press the button to replay the voicemails. And it's basically just two persons calling. One is a guy named Tony, who has, as he starts to speak, Twizzler's ears immediately peak up, because the guy speaks English, but with a very, very sharp Japanese accent, which I won't try to replicate here, because Japanese is an accent I can't really do. But he basically just says, "Hey, where you been? You missed our call. Call me when you get this." And his calls get more and more frantic the further along you go in the answering machine tape. And the last one is basically a guy sweating blood and bullets, asking, "Dude, I don't know what's up with you, but please, 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 please pick up bloody phone. I don't know where you are. If you have this forwarded, or was it your apartment and you weren't there? Please call me. God damn it, you know what they're gonna do. Call me. Just let me know what's up. We can sort this out. Please." Click, and it goes dead. And the other person that who calls is a female voice who doesn't even give a name, and just politely asks if he doesn't want to come into work, that he has to register a sick day. And from her there's four calls, and the fourth call tells him that his continued absence has led HR to the decision that his services are no longer required, and his work contract has been terminated. His personal effects, as they were, are kept as collateral for lost work. Hello, Nick's cat.
This is Bo, everybody.
Right, so, and just as the last message ends, you can hear Bleak Tomorrow shout, "Yes!"
Did I recognize the voice?
Might be a clue. I found a flyer for a casino, and I think this might be a clue to something.
Casino? Station like money.
Well, yeah, but it looks like he was visiting a casino, and it might explain his absence from work. Maybe he had a gambling addiction or a prostitute addiction.
What prostitute?
A prostitute, Mr. Station, is a person who you pay for sex. Surely you've heard of these before.
Snoo-snoo,
yes.
Okay.
So personally, I think we should follow this lead up because it could be very lucrative.
We go do some gamble.
No. We're going there purely for investigation. And should our money happen to fall into a place where you exchange it for chips, and should those chips fall into a craps table, then it's not our fault.
Yes.
Exactly. But what was that shit on the answer phone? Did you recognize the voice, Twizzle?
I don't know, did I?
Nope. You didn't know the voice. You can tell the guy was either born in Japan or he was raised over here with Japanese as his mother language.
Hmm.
Did he ever say his name on the answering machine?
Only his first name. He said he at one time said, "Hey, this is Tony."
Tony, sad Tony.
What about the flyers? I'm going to do some research on the Matrix on these flyers, the Brotherhood and the Velvet Room.
Give me a smarts roll first.
Five.
You know the Velvet Lady. The Velvet Lady is, in fact, a Yakuza establishment. It's as it's run by the Yakuza. Somebody rather distant from the chain of command where you were involved with. You've never been there, but... you know that it's part of it's part of the, it's run by the Yakuza.
And nothing on the Brotherhood?
Brotherhood is not something you don't know. If you want to do Matrix research, you can plug into his comm station to get Matrix access here from the apartment. And you find a automatically generated warning that his Matrix access has subscription has failed his payment twice, and if he fails a third time, they will cut his Matrix access.
Oh, good.
That's just an automatic message from the Matrix access provider you get when you check in. If you want to find something of the Universal Brotherhood, give me an investigation roll.
I'm going to walk into the kitchen.
Well, the food in the fridge is still good. The Universal Brotherhood seems to be some kind of quasi-religious cult that has been springing up all over the country. They propagate finding oneself through inner strength and a loving community where one can embrace his true soul's destiny and therefore rise out of your old life and become something more and something better as part of their community. They actually have quite a few outreach programs where they help people in need, like they feed feeding the homeless, providing overnight shelters. They run a rather big shelter in Chicago where homeless people can go and stay the night. If it gets too cold, for example, there's hot soup for them. And they don't seem to be the sort of cult that just cherry picks the people who bring money into the cult. From what you can dig up, they seem genuine in their message of compassion and helping other people. They really don't mind if you join in and have nothing. They have big chapter houses in each big city. They have a big chapter house here in Chicago where you can live when you don't have when you don't have an apartment of your own. And if you really have nothing, they try to provide for you, give you clothing, feed you. They have a small kind of education program for street kids to get kids off the street and learning, so they can perform certain tasks within the Brotherhood. Of course, they must have sponsors of some sort, or at least attract more people who are willing to give them money. Otherwise, they wouldn't be as successful. But they seem the real deal, which is surprising and very, very rare nowadays. So it's for a Decker who has his bread and butter in conspiracy theories, because that's what the Matrix runs on, cat pictures and conspiracy theories. It just makes you wonder how deep you have to dig to get to the dirty bottom.
Now, there's a phrase. Manuel.
Yes.
I'm thinking, considering that then, Bleak Tomorrow is going to turn to Twizzler and say, all that stuff you just researched, right? Why the fuck are we shadow running? If these guys are going to provide shit for us, we're putting our life on the line. Investigating this place is full of fucking dust. Let's go join this cult. What do you say, chaps? And then he turns and he puts his, sits down on the couch and just puts his arms up like this. And he's like, he's just said the best thing in the world.
I'm in the kitchen looking for food.
And then he starts up. He's like, join the cult. Join the cult.
The food in the fridge is still good. As I said, that stuff pretty much lasts forever. And
oh, yeah, sorry.
You have to put a few things aside that are made from krill. If you don't know krill, those are microscopic shrimps, and they just grind them into a paste and slap artificial flavor on it and make pseudo meat and pseudo hamburger buns and stuff out of that, and sausages. But there's a lot of stuff that's made from pure Nutrisoy, and yeah, you could eat.
Yum.
I'm gonna round up all the stuff that's not got any meat in it. And as I'm doing that, I'm gonna pack it all up and then walk in, and I can hear Bleak Tomorrow chanting, and I'm just like, O-N-M-M. As I walk in, but I have no idea what's going
join
on.
Join the cult.
And join, I'm like, man.
Twizzler, are you in? We're joining a cult.
You weird.
It's going to be good, man. They provide housing and shelter and all that shit. We won't have to Shadowrun anymore.
No, what? No, me like Shadowrun.
Okay, we'll join the cult, but while we're there, we'll ask about the fucking guy, Vanderburger.
Okay, I do this job my own. I get money, you get nothing.
Me like money. Me with Twiz.
All right, fine. I won't join the cult this time. I'll join them later. No, shut up. Okay, we'll do the mission, and then I'll join the cult. Deal?
If I'm looking to hide, I go to this place.
Okay, good. Anyway, it's got nothing to do with you guys. I'm joining the cult after we've done the mission.
Yeah, my man, Mo.
Yeah, exactly. You understand what he's saying?
I'm eating.
My man, Mo. Let's go.
Give me some of that stuff.
Here you go. Twiz.
To the casino.
I offer Twiz some as well. Twizzler.
Should we go to the casino, guys?
Casino,
yay!
I think we've deduced that he's in trouble with the casino, but he's hiding somewhere.
Oh. So we should go to the casino first. Listen, Twizzler. I think he might still be hiding in the casino, so we should go and investigate the craps table. Manuel, are you going for a piss?
I was pouring a water.
Mm-hmm.
See? Not yellow.
Yeah, okay. We go to casino. I need more energy drinks.
No, no. Okay, yeah, we'll go to the casino. Because we can ask where he went.
Yeah, since you started out rather late in the evening, the casino will be open when you arrive.
Hurrah!
Yeah. It's located on the borders of the west side, so you just probably just hail a cab and take it back. And as you go down the stairs, there's an older orc in a janitor's uniform punching in a code in the into the keypad. He's like, "Mick, mick, 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 mick,
mick." Should we tell him the code?
And he's he pulls out a mobile and hits a button and he's like, "Martha? Yeah, come down, the bloody gate's busted again. Yeah, I've got the bloody soy milk." Click. So as you go down, you just open the gate and he just squeezes through with trying not to make eye contact as he sees the troll. Just waits politely until you pass and then squeezes through and rushes up the stairs.
I blow him a kiss as I walk past like that.
You're not really sure if he noticed. Right, so you hail a cab and you go over to the Velvet Lady. The Velvet Lady is in the west side, on the borders of the west side. So, yeah, it's a casino, but it's not really a high-stakes kind of establishment.
Ah.
It's more like it's pretty working class, and that's the way it looks. So there's it's a Yakuza run place. So instead of the usual troll bouncers, you have two ridiculously cybernetically pumped up Japanese guys as bouncers at the door.
And I put down my visor, turn my voice mask on, and do my usual routine that I do with bouncers. And I say, "Excuse me, my man."
"Yeah, what do you want?"
"Me and my friends who need a VIP booth."
"You want what?"
"We need a VIP booth."
Sure, VIP booth. For you? 100. For
he's
him, 500.
"No. This guy gets it for free. He's the CEO of the Renraku Corporation."
Are you trying to intimidate them, or are you going for persuasion?
I'm just lying.
Which doesn't really matter because you don't have either. So that sounded rather intimidating. So give me an intimidation roll. So since you don't have that skill, you roll a d4 and your wild die and you subtract 2.
Yeah, man, I got a 0, but I'm going to Benny that shit.
All right.
So this time I got 2. It's not going to get any better than that. Oh, no, shit, it's exploding. Hang on. Hey! I got a 8. That's how it's done.
The guy stands there, and his partner is moving in a way that tells Twizzler and Pain Station that something bad is about to happen to Bleak tomorrow, but the guy Bleak is talking to just raises a hand and has this big grin on his face. "You funny. You know what? You go in. You save VIP booth. It's all right." And he holds the door open for you.
"Thank you."
Okay, as I walk past, I'm like, "Funny guy." And just point at him.
As I walk past, I put my hand up my head and do circles like, this guy crazy.
The bouncers, they don't even look at Pain Station, but as you enter, and they look at you and they like, they...
So, I pull my visor up and I go, where's the VIP booth then?
So,
hang on a minute. Shing me.
The casino seems to be built of two floors of a probably used to be a warehouse or something. The ground floor is the casino floor. You have a very long bar with a few barkeepers and many tables where gambling is happening. There are no slot machines or such. It's all tables. It's there are roulette tables, there's poker, there's blackjack. The air is filled with the mumbling and noise of a fill. It's not well filled, but there are attendants, and it's really, really heavy with smoke and the smell of cheap beer, cheap whiskey, and tons of bad life choices.
I turn around to these guys and go, smell bad.
I regret this.
I'm like, drink.
The guys manning the table are dressed not like you would imagine from an upscale casino. They're wearing jeans and normal shirts. And Twizzler looks around and those are obviously Yakuza tattoos they are sporting from his Gumi, from his Yakuza clan. And there are a lot of women and some guys around that are undoubtedly prostitutes, and they are just mingling in the crowd, trying to score an early mark.
I'm going to go up to Twizzler in that case, and I'm going to speak to him and go, just had an idea. Why don't we try and find the one that Cheeseburger, or whatever the fuck his name is, did the sex with, and then we ask her if... come on. I know I had a thought in there somewhere. If anything he said... Evidence. Oh, clue. Come on. I know I can do this. Do you get what I'm saying, Twizzler? Come on.
Okay, Bleak. You go talk to a girl.
Okay. Hello, prostitute. Come hither. I require services. I walk off towards the nearest cool girl.
Yeah, one of the girls, you turn a few heads with that shout, and...
I have wads of cash, and I wish to spend it on great... stuff.
Yeah, two of the girls look at you like you would look at a cockroach you just discovered under your bed sheet, and then you shout about the money, and they look at something a little more interested. And yep, the nearest of the girls approaches you, walks over to you with swaying hips. She's a human woman. Now that you have a look around, for Twizzler it's obvious, and he knows that's the way it is. And for you, as you look around, the patronage in here is mixed, but with a heavy emphasis on humans. And everybody who works here is either human, and a few of the working girls are elves, but there are no dwarves, no orcs, no trolls.
Okay, as the girl comes up then, I'm going to try and play a bit more cool. And he's going to go, yo, hey, babes. So I was wondering if I could have sex with the same person that Cheeseburger did last night.
Well, honey, I don't know. I don't know anybody named Cheeseburger, but
his name was Rose Martz.
But if you've got the money, we can involve a cheeseburger in it. That's okay. I don't mind.
And by the way, I just got... Oh my god. I just got 43 on my smarts roll.
Right, the table record for tonight is set 43, ladies and gentlemen.
I wish that was for something better than just remembering the guy's fucking name.
His name is James Vanderberg. And pro tip, you could take notes.
I'm not taking fucking notes, Manuel. That's not how I roll. So he goes, listen, I heard real good things about the woman that did the nasty on my mate James Vanderberger. Fucking hell. So listen, I want that same woman because apparently he did some real good nasty on there on my friend.
Oh, I can do all sorts of nasty things on you, baby. Not a problem.
Was it you? No, I want the same woman.
Right, all right. She shouts across the floor, Jenny! Get your skanky ass over here! And she just...
Whoa, come treat her with some goddamn respect, okay? There's no reason to say words to this, the S-K-N-K-Y word.
She just pops her bubblegum at you and turns around and leaves.
See ya.
The girl she shouted at crosses the floor, comes over to you. She's another human girl, early 20s, you'd say, with a look that says she's probably been doing this since she was 16 and fell in with the wrong kind of people.
Oh dear. Hello.
Hi.
I require grim services of the night.
Ew, I'm not really the grim kind of girl, but what do you have in mind?
A private room, you and I, and some kind of lewd activities.
I think that I can do. And then...
Righto! Off we pop. Don't worry, guys, I'm not actually going to go through with that. I'm going to pump her for information, and when I say pump, I don't mean... You know.
So, since you guys don't have any sort of wireless communications, you just turn around to the guys, say that while she stands next to you, and then leave with her.
No, I'm not going to say that. I'm not going to say that out loud. That was out of character, but what I'm going to say is, back in 15 minutes.
I'm like, okay, player.
She just, more like five. She just turns around to you two guys, winks at you, and says, don't worry, I bet I can finish him in 5.
I'm like, oh yeah.
She probably can.
Yep. Turns around and leads you upstairs. And upstairs, it's pretty much a cheap motel. There's room after room after room after room. And most of the rooms don't even have doors. They just have a heavy curtain you can close. And she walks through. She walks along the floor, and until she reaches one of the doors where the curtain is still open, motions you inside and closes the curtain after you.
Okay. Listen, I'm after information about James Vanderberger, and I can pay good money for it. How much does this sort of activity usually cost? I'll give you double.
James? What do you want with James?
He's gone missing, and any information that I find that will lead to his capture, I mean not capture, I mean rescue. Why did I use the word capture? Any information that will be helpful would be very helpful. I'm new at this, I do apologize. Listen, give me some information and I'll pay you double. He's gone missing. I want to know where he went after he, you know.
Make a persuasion roll with a +2 for the offer of money.
Thank God for that. Well, that's a 2 then.
Do you want to Benny that?
Yes, please. Yay! That's more like it. I got a 8.
Nice. So she seems to think it over for a moment and gives you a look you have had to endure for a very long time and very often in your life. It's the look people give you when they try to figure out if you are just crazy or if you are crazy and dangerous.
Well, it's because I'm wearing a cape right now.
And she seems to come to the conclusion that you are just crazy, but harmlessly crazy. So she just leans against the wall next to the curtain and crosses her arms. And well, it's been a while since I've last seen him. He's fairly regular in here, but he hasn't been here for, I don't know, about a week, I think.
Hmm.
And it was really I was hoping he would have snapped out of it and just came back.
Wait.
But last time,
out of what?
Last time, as when he was here, he was like you know those TV, those Tridio commercials about join our church and save your soul and all that nonsense, and he was pretty much like that. Just telling.
Which cult was it?
Oh god, the Unilateral Brothers of the Hood, something like that.
Good. That's all I needed to know. Right.
And he was alright.
Doesn't matter. Whatever you've got left to say, that's all I needed to know. I think we had some other evidence that showed that he probably went there anyway. So thank you for your time. Anyway, listen, you've been very helpful. Here's 35,000 new yen. Get yourself a real and get yourself into college, okay? I'll give her all my money. See you later.
Seriously?
Yeah, for real.
Okay. I honestly can't decide if you're just writing this out because this is supposed to be only a single adventure, or if Bleak Tomorrow is batshit insane.
No, it's because he sees himself as a modern day Batman, but he honestly doesn't consider the consequences of being an actual superhero and doing these deeds, so that's why he would do something so reckless.
Then you absolutely get a Benny for that.
Right, thank you.
Yeah, so you just hand over a crat stick with all your money, and she's just yeah, sure, and takes a portable stick reader that's in the room and slots the stick, and her eyes go like this, and then her eyes go wide, and she's like, is this for real?
Yes, but stop this stupid shit immediately. Go to college.
Okay, and
if I come back here tomorrow and you're not in college, you're going to be bloody annoyed.
And anything you say. And she just takes the chip out, stuffs it into her top, and runs out.
As she does that, I immediately get a sinking feeling of dread. And Bleak Tomorrow, as he stands there on his own, just goes, oh. Cool. Yeah, I'm done. I'm going to go back and meet these guys.
When you walk over, I'm like, how you do?
I think you joined the cult, guys.
You'll find me on the casino floor.
What you guys see before is the girl he went up with comes running down like a bat out of hell. And she just runs up. She runs to the bar in a back room. Comes out not 5 seconds later, has a cheap leather jacket on. Says something to the barkeeper and runs out of the door.
Yeah.
You might hear that, mate.
Yeah.
So he
nice
isn't
guy, really.
Yeah, he isn't up there very long. But what would you like to do in the meantime, guys?
I'm gonna hit the bar.
I'll be on the casino floor trying to get information out of the pit boss.
Okay, so give me a Twizzler, give me a streetwise roll with a plus two because you're obviously part of the family.
Seven.
Nice. You ask around, and after a while, you get referred to the guy who, at the moment, runs the floor, and he takes you aside a little bit, and says, "Yeah, Vanderberg. Yeah, he was pretty much a regular. Lost a lot of money here a while ago, a few years back. Lost really, really big, like, whew. And as far as I pushed it higher up the chain as usual. I don't really know what happened, but he's ever since then they said it was okay, and he was allowed to come back, and he's still gambling, but he seems to have learned his lesson. He's, truth be told, he's a really, really bad player, but he never loses more than 100 or so per night. And every once in a while, he takes one of the girls up upstairs. I think he has a favorite. I think Jenny. And yeah, that's and he last time he was here, he was, yeah, I remember last he was here, that was 3 days ago. We had to dump his ass out in the back alley. He was like totally crazy, just going on and on and on about that we should all join the Brotherhood and find our inner strength and the inner light and join a higher purpose, and just going on everybody's nerves. And so we had Yoshi just dump him in the back. Hasn't been here since.
Huh. Okay, I'll thank him and slip him 1,000 yen.
Yep, just bow slightly, and if I hear anything else, I'll let you know. Yeah, that's pretty much at the bar. It takes a while for Payne to even get recognized. You're pretty much used to being ignored and being made fun of simply for, whoa, what the bloody hell happened? Oh, great. Somebody put up a... crap. He put up a screen share and that totally screwed the window arrangement. That's gonna look really bloody funny on the stream.
Oh, nice one, Harrison.
Great. Okay, Harrison broke the cameras, guys. It's not my fault. do you guys want to take a short bio break if he's away?
Yes, please.
Sure.
All right, we're going to take a 5-minute bio break. We'll be right back. Don't touch the dial.
secret, man.
No, I didn't mean to. I didn't realize.
When you activated the screen share, that automatically resized your window in Skype to full screen.
Oh fuck! I'm so sorry, man.
And I couldn't change it back, so it totally broke the camera arrangement. Which is funny. I didn't even know that would happen. It's good to know.
I had no idea. I'm sorry, man.
No problem. Yeah, no problem. live and learn. That's good to know. Now I know for next time.
Well, I just won't do that again.
And now I know why Jamie gets so pissed off when somebody drops out of Skype and has to rejoin, because it messes up the camera arrangement.
Well,
I thought Skype allowed you to keep the...
If it does, I haven't figured out how. Whoops.
Back, Jax.
Oh, well.
Yeah.
We all are again. So yeah, so by the time Paint Station finally gets the attention from one of the barkeepers, the girl Bleak Tomorrow went up with comes running down, grabs a jacket, whispers something to the barkeeper that was just about to finally talk to you, and then takes off like a bat out of hell.
Hey...
So the barkeep is gone? Is that what you said?
No, the girl is gone.
Oh.
The barkeeper just looks after her and is like...
Like, what's with her?
Don't know. What do you want?
Am I done?
Beer. Station like beer.
Yep. She, he hands over a beer. Just a bottle. He opens it. He doesn't even bother filling it into a glass or something. Just puts a beer in front of you. That'll be 15.
Okay.
Get my little troll purse out and pay him some. Oh no, it's like a little memory stick, isn't it?
It's either crat sticks. Okay, the way money is handled in Shadowrun is money is pretty much all digital at this point. You have an account and you have a stick that's about as big as a pen, and that stick stores your SIN, your system identification number, which is your passport and ID, and it carries your licenses and personal information, biometric data, all that stuff. And it also carries the access to your accounts. There's a way to transfer money other than that. It's called a check stick. That's a stick that just has money on it and can be coded to a person, a specific person via biometrics, or just to anybody who knows a certain password, for example. Or it can be completely unprotected, which is a really stupid thing to do. In a few circles of the underworld, mostly ghettos and such, where they don't have access to matrix connections for stick readers, they still use a kind of cash. It's called plast money, and it's plastic coins which have a chip embedded in them, and the chip and the plastic's color tell you how much the chip is worth. So it's basically cash is all plastic coins with chips in them. Very illegal, but in certain areas the only way you can do business, as I said, mostly in ghetto areas and gang warfare zones.
Okay, cool. I'll pay on my normal stick.
Yeah.
Here you go. Thank you.
Yep, just turns around and walks away.
I'm like, rude. I'm going to look for my pals, see if I can see them, spy them.
Yep, Twizzler just finished a conversation with some other Japanese guy, and Bleak Tomorrow is coming down the stairs with a rather gloom expression on his face.
I'm looking white as a sheet. I'm just like,
I'm like, okay, I'm gonna walk towards towards Twizzler, but I'm gonna keep my eye on Bleak, and I'm like, think to myself, you know, look too hot.
You can stay at the bar. I'm gonna be heading over there.
Okay, cool.
So when I get up to the bar, I'm gonna slap my hand on the table and say, "Hey, you, you give me Moscow Mule."
Is that I think I know the. Is that actually a drink?
Yeah.
Moscow Mule. Yeah. Oh, all right. So then he just takes a slight bow because he obviously he's seen you talk to his boss, so he bows respectfully and mixes you a drink. And just puts it down in front of you, bows again, and backs off.
So, yeah, I'll tell Pain Station that something funky's going on. Something with the Yakuza, not really sure.
Don't mean to be a dick, but could somebody buy me a drink?
Oh, here he is. Why, you no have money. We just get paid.
I doubt it. I done an accident.
You lose card.
I'll start patting him down, trying to find his
credits. No, don't touch me. Don't touch me.
Maybe it's here. I'll look under his cape.
No, that's my penis. Look, yeah.
You can call it that.
I lost my stick. Could you buy me a beer? Could really do with one. I done a mistake.
It take long time for me to get served. I think it's cause me ugly.
And I'll look at Twizzler expectantly.
Twizzler, could I have the same as you, please?
I look at Pain Station and say, why are you so dumb? You smell, too.
Me no.
Trolls ever shower?
Rarely.
What is shower?
It's when water falls from the ceiling.
Like rain?
Kind of.
Yes,
I'll take a swig of my drink.
You know, like man-made rain. Anyway, I'm having a bad day.
Rain.
I saw an opportunity to be a hero and I took it and now I regret it.
You get information from Shnoo Shnoo?
Yeah.
So how was it?
How was she? I didn't have sex with her. I just...
Oh.
That also seems like a wasted opportunity. I should have had sex first and then got information, but I did I didn't even have the sex. I just got the information.
You ever done it before? You smell like you not.
Look, it doesn't matter. Point is, that's irrelevant, Pain Station. I think it's very rude, okay? Listen, I think that he joined the cult, okay? She said that the last time that they had nasty stuff, that he was blabbering about the cult, and she said that he was acting a bit mad. So I think that he went there. And I think maybe that it did have something to do with the Yakuza, as you said, but I think that he might have gone there to escape them, or maybe he's gone blithering mad. But I think he's gone there. I think that should be our next port of call. I think this whole trip is a bloody waste of time, and I gave all my money to that prostitute because I felt sorry for her and I wanted to be a hero, and now I think it was a waste of money.
Yeah,
we're going to the cult, yeah.
Yeah.
No. Actually, to be fair, they did say they'd give us free stuff. Maybe some of that will be 35,000 New Yen.
What?
Fingers crossed, eh?
Oh, shit.
Yes, I know that now. But she was so attractive.
The casino floor boss approaches Twizzler and hands him a chip. Says that may be of interest to you, or my. Just have a look at that. Just gives you a nod and walks off again.
I respectfully bow to him.
Tracking device.
Nope, just a normal data chip.
Oh.
See, I'll go look for a private place where I can pull my cyber deck out, jack in the chip.
Technically, you can just slot that into your chip jack. You don't need a cyber deck to watch a normal data chip. You have all the cyberware to watch it without the deck.
Okay, yeah, I'll do that then.
Yep. slotted in, and your display link in over your eyes springs to life, and it's a recording from these casino's security cameras, and it shows the back alley and the front of the casino. And the back alley is it's timestamped from the 3 days ago when they said they last saw him, and the alley is, there's just nobody there. Then the door opens and one of the bouncers drags James Vanderburg out of the building, and James is he's livid. He's struggling, he's kicking, he's screaming. The recording is video only, you can't hear what he's saying, but he's obviously screaming at the guy. And in one hand he still has what you know to be the Universal Brotherhood flyers, and is just waving them around and is hitting the bouncer with them over the head. And the bouncer is just, with a very annoyed expression on his face, is just dragging James out and then grabbing him by the neck and slightly at the lower back, and just throws him into the trash cans. Says something to him you can't hear, turns around and slams the door shut. James...
Okay, I'll relay that to everyone else and be like, this guy's crazy. He's definitely gone with the Brotherhood thing.
Yeah, it's not finished. James gets up out of the trash and dusts himself off as best as he can, which isn't really much. And he collects the flyers that he dropped very meticulously. He collects every single one, tries to brush water off some of them who got soaked, and puts them away in a pocket. He treats them very, very respectfully, you would say. And then he leaves the camera vision from the alley. And shortly after, he reappears in the cameras from the front entrance. And those cameras have a rather wide angle, a rather wide pickup area, as you know from other venues. That's usually to see if somebody's approaching in a not so friendly manner, in case there's no guards outside. So you have a view that's actually reaching across the street from those cameras, and you can see Vanderburg standing there for a while, and then it forwards for about 20 minutes, just as it's an automatic fast forward, and he gets picked up by two guys on bikes, and they are obviously part of a go gang. They have absolutely ridiculously tricked out racing bikes, armor plating, probably hidden weapons in there. They are wearing armored motorcycle suits, and one of the guys has an Uzi on his strapped across his back, and they seem to know him. They come to a halt near him, and the two bouncers, at a moment's notice, they are reaching for their guns, and as they see the go-gangers, but the go-gangers just exchange a few words with James. And then he hops onto one of the bikes, and they speed off into the night.
What is a go-ganger?
Go-gangs are motorized gangs that usually control highways and freeways and such. They ride heavily tricked-out bikes or cars.
Cool.
So they have fixed areas they control, like normal gangs do too, but usually they stick to roads where they can go really fast, and they usually collect insurances from transport companies and such. And if they can't do that, then they just plunder transports that aren't very well protected, which cross into their territory.
So would we know where this particular gang is? Would we have that information, or is that something we'd have to research?
Not you don't know them off the top of your head, but you could do some online research about that. Yep. So once you have,
actually, I think I'll just I think I'd just rather ask the bouncers at the front door.
Yeah, you just exchange a few words with them, and they saw the incident, but obviously not the sharpest tools in the shed, because they didn't think much of it, because the guys didn't make any trouble, and they didn't know the colors, and they weren't threatening the casino, so...
Okay, yeah, then I'll do some research on the Matrix.
Yeah, you can ask a barkeeper, and he grants you access to a back room where there's a comm unit where you can jack into the Matrix. So give me a investigation roll.
I got a 3, so I'll use a bunny to re-roll it.
Okay.
And a 5.
You search for the gangers by the patterns and schemes of their colors. You could see part of a symbol. They are mostly colored in green, and their logo seems to be a kind of leprechaun. And from that you find a lot of news articles about them in the Matrix. It's a gang called Murphy's Law. They are located in the news, and every now and then they make the news when they try to expand their territory to a part of the inner city motorways that crosses into the north side, for example. And the north side gangers don't like that very much, and then there's a clash and a firefight and a few deaths and usually a few thousand Nuyen collateral damage. And up to this point, Murphy's Law has never won that fight. So they seem to control area in the news, which makes them very, very dangerous customers. The news is a really rough area to be at as a gang. And from what you can tell, they are in the news fairly regular and have been for quite a while, at least for 2 or 3 years. And that's a long time to be active as a gang in such an area. Usually the smaller gangs, they change every 1 to 2 years, because either they get too big and splinter and die from infighting, or if they are small, they die because some other gang wanted their territory and finally had enough firepower. So that they were able to hang on to their territory for that amount of time means they are either very competent and smart, or they have outside help, which isn't unheard of. There are gangs that get support from organized crime. There's a few gangs that are basically on the payroll of the Yakuza, which you know of, and they're nothing more than hired muscle. But by doing that work, they earn themselves a sort of protection. So that's one way for a gang to increase their life cycle.
So I'm going to relay that information to Pain Station and Bleak tomorrow. Sounds like to me like the Brotherhood is supporting the Murphy's Law gang.
Well, we better bloody well go there then. But they seemed like such nice guys earlier.
So where do we want to go? Do we want to go to the Brotherhood's outfit, or do we want to go to Murphy's Law turf?
I personally think Brotherhood first, but it's up to you, really. I think Murphy's Law is going to be dangerous. There's going to be fucking fighting all over the place. I do think that, obviously, it's a good lead, but I just think that it's all going to lead back to the Brotherhood eventually anyway, so why not go there?
Makes sense.
Yeah.
Pain Station?
What do you reckon, Nick?
Yeah, that sounds good.
I ain't able.
Yeah, it's Brotherhood time, boys. Let's go. Let's do this. Let's go kill some cultists. I mean, reason with them. Yeah? Yeah.
Yeah.
I think Bleak tomorrow would fit right in.
Oh, yeah.
You're the one that said you wanted to join.
I am going to join. I am going to join them. Ignore the gun. I don't know what it is. But all right, cool. Yeah, we're going to go to the Brotherhood, man. Well,
right. So you hail yet another cab. Driving through a now very dark, as dark as a night can get in a modern city. There's always street lights and neon signs advertising for this and that and something other.
Before we get there,
yep.
In the cab, could I ask the cab driver to put DMX's X Gon' Give It To You on the radio? I would like to ask him that based on the fact that I think that I say to him, by the way, we're investigators and we're nearing the conclusion of the investigation. We're getting somewhere and I feel G'd up. Could you put this on? And I hand him my music player and ask him to plug it into his car stereo.
There's no way for you to physically hand him something, because in that area, cabs are armored on the outside. Not very visibly armored, but yeah, and the passengers are in a separate compartment from the driver, and the driver is protected with bulletproof glass.
In that case, I put my headphones in during the journey, and I go, "See you in a bit, guys. It's time to go to my special place." And I put DMX's X Gon' Give It To You on.
Nice.
And then you can hear me going, pop, pop, open up the door, it's real!
So you can enjoy the drive while Bleak Tomorrow mumble sings DMX X Gon' Give It To You on repeat to himself.
Oh, yeah.
And you stop. The cab stops in front of the Universal Brotherhood building, and the driver just takes a look outside and notices where you are and says, that place. Heard my sister joined them. Seemed like a nice bunch.
The cab driver says this.
Yep.
Which one's your sister?
I don't know if she's here.
Okay. Well, you're
her name
extremely
Jenny?
Helpful.
Yeah, that's what I'm here for.
I'm going to try and rescue her.
Now pay up and get out.
Okay, well, that's not going to happen. I don't have any money.
I'll pay.
Here you go, man.
How much was it?
That's covered by your lifestyle.
Okay.
So the money you have extra is the money you've written down in extra and left over from your character start. That's just for anything you want to buy that's not covered by your lifestyle. Your lifestyle covers your apartment, heat, electricity, water, food, and means to getting around the city, either by paying for the petrol in your car or by paying for cab rides and a monthly bus pass and monorail pass and stuff like that.
So I'm going to have to stay with one of you guys then, because I'm out of cash.
I'll look after you.
So, so your lifestyle, Harrison, your lifestyle is for the moment is paid for a full month. So that means you probably have 2 weeks to come up with your next payment. And if you don't come up with the money by then you get evicted.
Uh-oh.
I think we'll solve
to live in this.
I think we'll solve this whole thing before 2 weeks. I think we'll be all right.
Hoping.
Yeah. Yeah, yeah, I'll be
living at my house.
That'd be fun. I'll sleep on the troll sofa. It'll be massive.
Be mad out of bones.
All right.
The Universal Brotherhood building is... Oh, man. Do I have the logo? Crap, there's actually a Universal Brotherhood. No! Okay, put in a qualifier, Shadowrun. Do they have a logo? Because I can't remember. Nope, guess they don't. All right. So the building you approached is an old commercial building, but it has been fixed up rather well. You are in the north side, so it's a lower working class area, and usually the buildings here are really, really run down. Here it's this. Ah, crap, that's probably not good of done. Sorry.
Have you just pooped yourself, Manuel?
God damn it, how the fuck do you close this? I opened something and now everything is broken. But it took a while for me to break something. That's myself. I take that as a good sign. Thank you. So the building used to be some kind of commercial building, probably with a lot of administrative companies and such. And they really tried to fix it up, clean it. They actually painted it. It's painted. It used to be painted white. And it wasn't that long ago that they actually painted it. The problem with Chicago is if you paint something white, you either have the money to pay for smart paint, which costs a fortune, or it's gray after 2 days because of all the steel industry smog. So this is gray, which means they painted it not too long ago, which is a pain to do in winter, so... They really seem to care about the looks of this place and have a handmade wooden sign that says Universal Brotherhood with their logo on it over the entrance door. And it's pretty well lit. Seems to be, despite the late hour, it's after midnight now, it seems a lot of activity inside.
Okay, I'm going to approach the door and I'm going to activate my voice mask and put my visor on my helmet down.
We seek the boss of the place.
Yep, there's nobody at the door, but the door's unlocked so you can enter.
No, I just shout it into the door.
Did you open it or did you just shout it at a closed door?
I open it slightly.
Okay.
Just like a tiny little crack. I go,
we seek the boss of the place.
Response from inside.
There was a lot of mumbling inside, a general noise of many people going about whatever business, and that dies down immediately as you shout it. And if you take a peek inside, there's it's a big lobby, and there's about 20 people there, and all of them are looking in your direction. It's a mix of a lot of standard working folk and a few squatters who seem to seek shelter for the night. And there's four people in there dressed in. At first, you thought it was a bathrobe, but it's an actual white robe. They're actually white robes.
Okay, in that case, I'm just going to go quickly.
Actually, hang on a minute.
And I close the door again, and I turn around to Twizzler, and I say,
wait a minute, from all your research, do you think these guys can be trusted?
They look legit online. Trusted? No.
Do you think something bad's going on in here, and I should superhero this shit? I should go full Batman, is what you're saying.
You're not wise.
No.
Old man.
Put gun down.
Put gun down for now. Bang, bang in okay. Pocket.
I take my helmet off and put it in my backpack, and I then open the door again and go, hello. Wow, did anyone see that weird guy who just came past? I was wondering if I could join the cult.
Wait, with your gun out? I'm confused.
No, I put the gun away.
You put the gun away, right, okay. So you re-enter and ask. So you almost run into a woman in a white robe that was about to approach the door and for whatever reason. And you nearly bump into her, and she just takes a hasty step back to not bump into you.
Oh, excuse me, madam.
Quite all right. I'm Sister Renata. Can I help you?
Yes, my friends and I wish to join your wonderful cult of goodness.
Oh goodness. We wouldn't really say we're a cult. We like to think of us more as family.
Goodness me, there's no need for that language. You just called me well, I'm not even going to say it. But anyway, my friend here, Pain Station, ignore the name, he is a troll, and he wishes to become a better person. And my other friend here, Twizzler, is Japanese.
All right.
And we see this. Our friend James Vanderberg gave us this flyer, said we should come here and join.
Yes. Wonderful James. So where do we sign, old, what did you say your name was?
Renata, I don't...
Sister...
...know any James, but that's wonderful news if you, heard of us from one of ours. If you want to join, I'm very happy to hear that. And, you get the idea that she's... Actually, she's really sincere with that, and she has no problem with... She doesn't seem fazed at all by Bleak's strange behavior. She didn't bat an eye when a troll walked in. And she gestures over to a counter where another one of the rogue people stands behind and is talking to some other people at the moment. If you just go over to Brother Clemens over there, he can help you with our signing up process.
Okay.
We offer that actually in various phases, so you can... just become a contributor if you wish to and get more familiar with our workings and our teachings. So you can basically familiarize with what we do and what we represent and what we're trying to do in the world. You don't really have to completely sign up from the get-go.
Oh, well, we would very much like to. We're going to go full Kickstarter level. We're backing all the way, baby. We're getting aboard the cult train. Beep, beep.
Boop, boop.
Right. Okay. Then I suggest you...
Does the application process... does the application process allow me access to one of their Matrix computers?
That's all we need, isn't it?
So is that an in-character question?
No.
As you walk over to the counter, and as you can see, they handle applications actually on paper here.
What century is this?
What the fuck is paper?
Depending on
robot paper.
In this version of Shadowrun, in Shadowrun 2, paper isn't all that uncommon. The news faxes every morning come on paper, and depending on the area you live and work in, paper isn't that uncommon. Especially in the lower income areas. So, and the area here is pretty much as low income as you can get if you don't want to walk into the news.
Shit.
So yeah, that's not really much of a... that's not that unusual. The guy himself has a terminal where he then enters the information the people give on their signing sheets, and he just asks them some follow-up questions and inputs that information as well. Right now he's talking to an older orc couple, and older for orcs means they're about in the mid to end 30s.
So we have to wait till they're done for our turn to sign up.
Yeah.
Get a move on, Grandma.
The brotherhood looks up to you. Please, there's no need for harsh language. I'll be right with you. Please sit down for a moment. I think there's coffee in a pot. And there may be some bread left, I think, from dinner.
Mm.
Please help yourself. I'll be right with you.
My friend here can only eat meat.
I don't think we have any. Sorry.
Meat is murder.
But you could ask in the kitchen if you want. It's right through that door.
No, I can't be bothered. I'll just go and grab a coffee and wait for my chance to sign up.
I'm going to start munching the bread.
Where's the restroom?
End of the bread.
Restroom also through that door near the... besides the... well, we call it a dining room. It's a rather fancy name, but it fits.
You call the restroom the dining room?
No, the restrooms are near the dining room.
That's what I thought you said. Toilet.
So yeah, I'm gonna go wander in that direction and just kind of wander around the building from there.
I'm gonna wink at Twizzler. Hey,
yeah, I guess. Yeah. So the lobby is not that crowded, but there's only four of the Brotherhood people, and there's about 20 to 30 people here. So you can walk around without being bothered too much.
I want to look at and try and see if there's any... Are there any Brotherhood guys that aren't wearing a robe?
None that you can tell. As far as you can tell, there's really only four actual members of the Brotherhood here, and they are all four wearing
robes. Because obviously that Renata woman, right? She looked like she was important, and then there's Clementine at the desk who's probably important. But is there, I want to just discern, is there one that just looks like he's just doing his day-to-day job that doesn't really give a fuck? Can I roll out notice to have a look?
Sure.
Okay, what is my notice? I left my character sheet over there. Right, it is gonna be D10, mate. Okay, here we go.
Holy shit.
I got a 7.
Yeah, and remember you have a +2 because you have awareness.
Oh yeah, I do. Yeah, so I got a 9.
You don't really think that any one of them is the boss.
Mm-hmm.
They seem to be all on the same pay grade, for lack of a better word. But Sister Renata is the most mobile one. The other three are Brother Clemens is manning the counter and handling applications, and the other two guys are mainly there to answer questions of people and help and talk to people. And Sister Renata seems to be the one who's handling everything that involves leaving the room. She at one point brings a new pot of coffee, which means she before that she just left the room, goes over to the dining area and comes back with a fresh pot of coffee and puts down some cookies.
Mm-hmm. Okay, which are, I'm gonna go.
Yep.
Up to one of them, and just one of the ones that's not the two that I mentioned earlier.
Yep.
When you cast a spell in this, does it have like in Shadowrun Second Edition, does it have like a verbal component or anything like that? Or nope. Can I just cast it silently?
Nope. You can just cast a spell, say it in your head, and it happens. The more powerful magic is, the more probable it is that it manifests in one way or another in the physical realm.
Mm-hmm.
But that depends heavily on the spell. So what do you which spell do you want to cast?
I'm going to use confusion at some point, but I want to go up to one of them and start talking to them first.
Well, confusion is I don't think you really pick have you picked a trapping or right, but I don't know, what exactly does your confusion spell do?
Makes them like go into a confused state for a short amount of time. I know in the Shadowrun 5th they have either single target confusion or mass confusion.
So it just blasts their mind with magical energy to make them lose their coherent train of thought. Some exactly. Sort of thing. All right. Okay.
So I want to go up to one of them and start talking. I just go oh my lord, I'm putting on a voice for some reason, and he's going to go, oh my lord, I've lost my way, I want to tell you about how I have sinned, brother. Can I speak to you in private just over there just for a few seconds, my brother?
And he's like, excuse me for a moment, to the squatter he was talking to, and if you think it's that urgent, please, by all means, just follow me.
I'm really sorry. I'm waiting to sign up to join the Brotherhood. I'm just really, really upset about all the stupid shit I've done in my fucking stupid, shitty life.
Yep, he nods to the squad and says, just
hallelujah.
Grab a coffee, Martin. I'll be right back with you. And he puts an arm around you in a really He tries his best to do it in a non-threatening manner and leads you away from the crowd a bit.
I think even though I don't need to do it, Bleak Tomorrow would cast it in a verbal component anyway. So while he's talking to him, he goes, forgive me, Father, for I have sinned, confusion, basically. And then he just, as he casts the spell, he just reaches into the guy's pocket and takes his ID, puts it into his own pocket, and then just walks away and then goes back into the queue.
Okay, cool. Then give me a spell casting roll.
Yep, spell casting. Way fuck, I dropped my dice. Here we go. That is a 5.
Yeah, usually that's the idea, to drop them. Otherwise they don't really roll. Right, so that means he gets to make a smart roll at -2 to defend himself. And on the topic of dropping dice, bloody hell.
Hey. Exactly. Hey.
You were being so smug. Oh, wow. Okay, that's a 6. And a 1, that's a 7. You had what?
I had 5.
You had a 5. Okay, that means he actually beat you. So,
motherfucker.
So, yep, that's not the way it works. So, you. I should technically I should have asked you if you wanted to let it stay at a 5, because that's then you...
I did anyway, so
yeah. Yeah. So this time, because I forgot to mention it, if you want to Benny your role, I'll allow it, because I forgot.
Okay, can I then, please?
All right, so you can Benny it, because... Totally
yeah,
my
I'll
fault.
Benny it. I'm gonna reroll.
Yep.
Okay, I got a 7. what happens then?
That means it's equal, and that means the defender wins. So you need an 8 to beat him.
I'm going to re-Benny it then.
All right.
Come on. Means that's more like it.
One Benny left.
17.
All right, so that means he had a... You get a Benny back because I'm an idiot. He rolled a 7. What? He rolled a 7, but he rolls at a minus 2. So he had a 5, which means your 7 beats his 5. Okay. So, okay.
Actually, you know what? While I'm at it, I'm going to go not only for his work ID, like his pass, because I'm thinking he might have, like, the reason that I'm going for that is because he might have a high security clearance, but also... I think Bleak Tomorrow would go for his cred stick too.
That is pretty much that's so broke. You don't really see any ID badges on them, and in the short time you have to go through his pockets, it's all you really find is his cred stick, and but. That could be that they're using that.
Religious.
Yeah, but it could be that they're using the cred sticks as ID badges.
Oh, good point. Yeah, because it's got a sin on it, hasn't it?
Yep.
Okay, cool. Fuck it. I'm happy with that. I'm going to take that then.
Yeah.
Pencil.
So, he's he stumbles. He loses his step, and his eyes glaze over for a moment.
Okay, when he comes back too, I'm going to go, and then I punched her in the face. Well, thanks for listening. See you later.
Wow, that's hot.
No, that's the end of the story. Bye.
All right. I hope you find forgiveness for your...
Shut up. See you later.
It's in... Ooh. he walks through the room back to one of his co-workers, and you can hear him say, I don't feel so good. I think I'm going to sit down for a moment. And he just he wanders off into the sitting area and just plops down and pours himself a coffee.
Is there any way to check how much money's on the cred stick?
If you have a cred stick reader or a cyber deck, then yes.
I do not.
Then no. Twizzler, you can walk around pretty much unbothered. The dining area is just another pretty large room that has some tables and chairs in them, which obviously have been collected from various sources. And they have a small corner that was set up as a kitchen. They have an auto cook where they can prepare various soy food and instant food and such stuff, with a big refrigerator and two doors that lead to the lavatories.
So there's no private offices or anything in this area?
There are further doors leading away from the hall, from the lobby. There is one room behind the counter with Brother Clemens, with a closed door, and there is a double door that leads further into the building, which is closed and protected with a lock. A magnetic lock. Electronic lock, I mean. from
is
from,
that out in the open, or is that in the hallway that I'm in?
That's pretty much out in the open. That's it's pretty much the entrance is not really a hallway. It's a large foyer. So it's as soon as you enter the building, it's one big room where everybody is greeted and talked to and may sign up, and then there's another big room where they can eat, and then there's the big the double doors that lead further into the building.
Okay, I'm gonna walk back over to Pain Station and get him to give me some cover while I can try to defeat the electronic lock.
Stand in front. Yeah, I'm gonna turn around and be broad and kind of overshadow Twizzler so he can get up to what he needs to do. And
I like that you announced, like you said out loud what you were doing. You're like, stand in front.
Yeah, but like no one listens to me.
Yeah, because you're a troll.
Yeah.
It's like Street Fighter.
Outsider, yeah, exactly.
Very nice. So as you approach the double doors, you can see Bleak Tomorrow walking away from the crowd with one of the guys having an arm around his shoulder. And Twizzler, give me a stealth check, and Nick, give me a notice check, please. If you're rolling on a skill you don't have, you roll your wild die and a d4, and you subtract 2 from the result.
I got a 3.
Do you want to Benny that?
Snake eyes. Yeah, I'm going to Benny mine as well, please.
Yep.
Yeah, I'll go ahead and Benny it.
All right, so Twizzler, you're down to your last Benny.
Yeah, I got a 1 this time.
Okay, you nice. can't get worse through the use of a Benny, so that's a 3.
So I'm going to Benny mine again, please.
All right. That good, huh?
Yeah.
Please.
Man, I got 3.
Wow. Okay. So I'm going to roll a generic notice roll for the group of people who are there. So that means I won't roll 20 dice, but I'm going to roll a standard notice die with a skill die with a wild die because I'm rolling them for a group. And at the moment, they are either occupied with their own stuff or a little bit distracted by Bleak Tomorrow's antics. The troll may be the biggest person in the room, but Bleak Tomorrow is definitely the elephant in the room at the moment.
Yes! It worked!
Yeah, so I'm going to roll that for them. Crap, and that one explodes. Yeah, so that's a 9. So somebody notices, and Pain Station doesn't realize it until they are almost on top of you guys. Since you tried to cover for Twizzler, you can react now. There's one of the other Brotherhood guys is it's Sister Renata. She's she is approaching you to and just kind of looking what you're doing, and you have a chance to do something before she sees Twizzler fidgeting around with the lock.
Okay, cool.
Do I notice any of this?
Nope. You are concentrated on your work.
Okay.
I'm gonna be like, why me so angry? and then I'm gonna point at my homemade champ belt and go, me broken.
And then give me a persuasion roll.
Okay. Ooh, lovely. Ooh, hello.
You're exploding,
Nick. Yeah, big time. That's a 16.
Wow, nice. Yes. So
tear, one single tear drips down my eye as if, like, and I just look at her really wantingly as if say, I need answers.
We're nailing this, man.
Yeah, she,
this is the best application process ever.
she stops on in her steps and looks at the belt, and then looks up and she sees the tear, and she actually goes she has to stand a little bit up on the tips of her feet, but she reaches out and places her hand very, very softly on your cheek, and she says with the softest voice, says, we all carry pain within us. It's how we approach it that's important in going forward. And you are here, and you reached out to people who want to help you. And that is a big step. That is perhaps the largest step there is. So you may feel pain, but that will pass. You are already on the right way to find the strength within you. And maybe we can help you. If you let
maybe
us.
Maybe one day, me no more pain station. Me, happy station.
Yes, exactly like that. That is...
I'm going to go in for a big hug.
Go, you make pain happy.
From the other side of the room, I see this and I go, gay!
Jesus Christ. She actually hugs you back, and then she stiffens as she hears the shout. And whoever wrote something in Skype chat, if I open the Skype chat, it screws up the window arrangement. So if you write something that's also interesting to me, write it in the Hangouts chat, please.
Oh, it's not important. I was telling Nick to say something.
Okay. And then, yep, she just turns around for a bit and motions to the last guy that's standing around at the moment. And he walks over to you and says, friend, we are trying to spread peace, and if you feel ready for that, then we will welcome you. But please don't disturb the others who are trying just to find a bit of quiet and peace in here.
When I look to the guy who I confused earlier and say, exactly, that's what I was trying to tell him, but he kept shouting things like gay at you guys, and I was saying to him, stop shouting and disturbing their moment, idiot, I say to him. Can I roll persuade? That works.
Yeah. It's probably not...
That's the double ones there, Manuel.
So his face hardens visibly, and you see, I am pretty sure he didn't, and I would ask you very politely to leave.
Okay, I'm sorry, I'll be on my best behavior from now on. I didn't mean to offend you. It's just that it was a bit that moment made me feel a bit sick when I saw it, so but from now on I won't do that again. I'm sorry.
Sure you will try to, but you are disturbing many people here, so please leave.
Okay, I can't though because of a multitude of reasons. So I'm gonna stay here. So no. Respectfully, no.
Can I hear this?
I see. You are too far away to actually hear all the words, but you get the gist of the conversation.
Listen, I do. It's outbursts like that. I just can't control myself sometimes, and I want to be a better guy, okay? And I'm sorry, all right? I didn't mean to shout that. I just thought it'd be funny, and it wasn't. And that's why I want to be a better person, okay? And this place can help me be that, all right? So just let me stay. Just give me one more chance, okay?
You stay right here for a moment. And he walks over to the guy you confused. and begins talking to him. Twizzler, give me a hacking roll. Which is, in this case, the same as the pretty much a decrypt roll for it.
Yeah, I rolled a 2, so I'm going to Benny that.
All right, so that was your last Benny.
5.
All right, that is a standard success, and that is enough to overcome the lock's encryption. It is indeed a standard ID reader, which is used for anything. As you can slot in a SIN or a specially designed ID stick to open the lock. And you have access, so you can reprogram it a bit. It's a bit more sophisticated, so if you are trying to mess with existing profiles, that would probably take a bit of time. But if you simply want to add one of your IDs as a as an approved ID to the list, that you can do with that role.
Yeah, I'll just plug my SIN in there as a access granted.
All right, perfect. Right, so you do that.
So as I finish that up, I stand up and turn around and I see what's going on. And I say, "Hey, you guys, shut fuck up! I'm trying to work here."
Sorry.
And then I'll turn around and open the doors.
If you open the doors, the people in the room will see that. So they will notice that doors open that probably shouldn't open for you.
Well, yeah. And I kind of shouted that out, what I said. So.
Yeah. So. Wait, so you are you want to open the doors or what?
Yes. Okay. I'm opening the doors.
Okay.
Why don't we just sign the forms?
That'd be too easy.
Well, yes, you shout that to your comrades and you you click your SIN into it and the door opens. And the door opens into a hallway that leads indeed further into the building and to an elevator shaft. And there's a few doors left and right in the hallway. Some are closed, some are open. And there's two guys, two other Brotherhood members standing in the hallway, and they're turning their heads as the door opens, and it's not really a what was that. So it's more this millisecond turn of your head you do when a door opens into the room you are in, and they just look over there, and they look at you standing there with your cyber deck in front of. Now open doors, a troll behind you, and one of them, an older human, takes two steps towards you and says, "Can I help you?" And his eyes are less on you, more on the cyber deck in your hands.
I'm gonna pull out my knife and try to get behind him and grab him by the throat and hold the knife to his throat.
Okay, so this is happening.
Okay, wow.
Okay,
I did not see that coming. Okay, then a quick question: how much more time do we have for today? Because I know Matt, you have to go because of your kids.
Yeah, my kids just got walked in the door actually.
Okay, so then this is going to be the point where we break for tonight. with Twizzler taking a hostage at knife point. Awesome. That is so great. Wow, it was nice.
I would assume that Pain Station and Bleed Tomorrow are going to pull out weapons too.
I was going to just try and bundle in with Twizzler and try and grab him, just kind of overpower this guy, because I've seen Twizzler taking the lead, so.
Yeah. Brilliant, nice one.
Going to pull a wrestling move out, like the old days.
Great work. That's going to be awesome. What could possibly go wrong? All right, so that's everything we have for tonight, guys. Our next chess session is planned, and if I remember my calendar correct, it will be in exactly 2 weeks. When we meet again, same channel, same time, 18:30 GMT, to continue with the mayhem that is probably about to ensue in the Universal Brotherhood chapter in Chicago. Okay, Nick, Harrison, you guys are hosts of a podcast. Would you like to plug your where you do wonderful things for the RPG world?
No, thanks. we host a podcast called Tabletop Twats. You can find that at wherever you download your podcast. Just search for Tabletop Twats. In it, Nick?
Tabletop Twats. Also, yeah, if you love Savage Worlds, we're also part of another podcast called The Wild Die Podcast, which is all about Savage Worlds. So if you'd like to learn more about it, if you're new to it, or you know, come on over and say hi on there as well.
If you like lewd material, we're on Pornhub.
Nothing lewd on Wild Die, but yeah, lots of lewd stuff on the Tabletop Twats, sadly to say, but yeah, it's a little bit more adult, but it's come say hi to us.
It sounds like we actually do lewd content now. You say it's a little bit more adult.
We just swear a lot until
poor choice of words. I'm actually going to be on the Wild Die podcast in the episode this Sunday.
Yes, you are.
I'm going to talk.
I'm not bloody able to make it on.
I'm going to talk about Savage Worlds in Germany in general, and I'm going to talk about the conversion I am running right now, Savage Shadowrun Second Edition. So, if you would like some more in-depth information about the conversion you can't get from reading it, check out the Wild Die podcast episode that is going to be released Sunday or Monday, I think, because we're going to record it on Sunday, so it's going to be out on Monday, I think.
Or if you just want more Manuel.
Or if you just want more me.
Exactly. Yes. I'll be listening.
More me. Always good. Ladies, I am taken. Sorry. Guys, I'm taken also. Sorry. Matt, anything you want to plug on the show, or just say a few choice words?
Check out Jamie Pearson. He's got the RPG Brewery. First show is this Friday on Twitch.
Hey, that's absolutely right. From the Nerds, the founder of the Nerds International Network is going to be back with a bang with the RPG Brewery. I can't wait for that first episode. It's going to be epic.
Cool. Also, follow Matt Stark on Google Plus. He's a good guy to follow.
He is a good guy to follow, yep.
Yes, so you can find me on... How does Harrison like to say it? The Joogles. I'm on Google Plus. Search for Veiled Fury Entertainment, or my private account, Manuel Sams, as it's pronounced in German, or Manuel Sams, as it's pronounced in English. Until then, I say to you, thank you for watching. I will see you in 2 weeks, or probably a little earlier if you're watching this on YouTube as a recording. And until next time, I'm Manuel Sams for Veiled Fury Entertainment, and I say to you, keep rolling and stay savage. Goodbye. We're out.
Thanks, Manuel.
Thank you.